I welcome you again in the second session of day 8. And in this session, we have the surprise talk by surprise speaker. So our today's surprise speaker is Dr. Shashanka Deka. So I, on behalf of the committee, my department and my university, I warmly welcome Dr. Shashanka Deka to kindly accepting our invitation and came here for this surprise lecture. And also I welcome again to all participants to be with us since morning. So Dr. Shashanka Deka is the associate professor in the Department of Chemistry, University of Delhi. He received his MSc from University of Guwahati in 2001 and PhD from National Chemical Laboratory, NCL Pune in 2007. He then moved to National Technology Laboratory, NNL, CNR, INFM, Lissi, Italy, and Italian Institute of Technology, Genoa, Italy for postdoctoral research. He has been awarded the TMS Foundation 2008 Sri Ram Arora Award by the Minerals, Metals and Materials Society, TMS, Verendley, USA, DAE BRNF's Young Scientist Award in 2011, Institute of Physics, UK Best Cited Paper Award in 2019. Dr. Shashanka Deka has published more than 65 research papers in different international peer-reviewed journals, 2 patents, and also wrote 2 books and 2 book chapters published by international publishers. He has received the research citations of more than 3,300 with an H index of 31 and ITIL index of 48. He has successfully handled several extramural research projects from various funding agencies like DST, CSIR, SERB, DBT, DAE, etc. His current research interest deals with synthetic nanochemistry, multifunctional hybrid nanocrystals, novel nanocatalysts for energy research, and nanomaterials for energy storage. Dr. Shashanka is doing excellent work on various aspects of the nanomaterials, and today he will speak on very interesting title, that is the nanomaterials, the synthesis diverseness. So with these words, I request Dr. Shashanka to please come up and start your special lecture. Thank you. Yeah, please.
Is it afternoon, everybody? And sorry for this short delay. This is unexpected. Power cut was there, so just for 1 minute, and it takes 5 minutes to the router to restart again. Okay, and thanks, Professor Tokay Ramet, for giving me this opportunity to speak something in front of you. So basically, in the last few days, I also attended many of the lectures. And you can see that most of the lectures, all we discussed about mainly the sustainability and the energy. So you can see most of the works, the great works, those are based on the this application of nanomaterials for energy conversion and storage, most of that, and few of them on bio medical part also, means application in nanobiotechnology. Then I thought that I will choose something that is different, that is the synthesis part, because without synthesis, we cannot do any study further. And I'm a chemist, so we do chemistry, so we try to understand some of the synthesis methods for the nanomaterial. And as we know, that application of nanomaterials, and we can see there are a lot of application starting from biomedical, construction, electronics, and energy storage, environmental remediation, food packaging, renewable energy. So basically, from the first day, if we see most of the talks say this designing of catalyst for water splitting, photoelectrochemical. If you see the first lecture, then Professor P.D. Sharma also showed various quantum dots of different colors, color emitting. Then Professor Ganguly also shows that getting different kind of nanomaterial for electrocatalytic and photocatalytic water splitting reactions. So we And you can see, if you check in the internet, you can see there are a lot of commercial application of nanomaterial for a lot of application actually. And this is also one slide. You can see this is about in the public domain. And we can see the process development, property characterization of these nanoparticles, and we can get different kind of nanoparticles. And those particles are used in different parts of the globe. Say, for example, for supercapacitor, or as a catalyst for organic transformation reactions, then carbon dioxide reduction, then drug delivery, sensing, etc., etc. So what is today's our part is that parts of process development and property characterization, that how we synthesize nanomaterial, what are the different theories behind those synthesis to get very nice nanoparticles. Okay, so this is one slide. You can see a lot of nanoparticles are used in different domains, say gold nanoparticle, iron nanoparticle, zinc oxide, silicon dioxide, silver nanoparticle. One of the best example, you can see silver nanoparticles are used as an antibacterial agent in the bandage, in lot of antibacterial creams, etc. So how do you prepare nanoparticles? So that is different thing. And to get have the idea about a nanoparticle, another thing. So I know you have, you know already the definition of nanoparticle, that generally what we define that if a nanoparticle, if a particle is below 100 nanometer in any one of the dimensions, say we have three dimensions, X, Y, Z, out of that, if any one of the dimension is less than 100 nanometer, that is general definition for the nanoparticle. And nanomaterial may be anything, oxide, semiconductor, alloy, metal nanoparticle, polymer, bioparticles, anything. And this is a interesting world of nano, and from this all lectures you can see that this what is called a nanotechnology is a big word referring to small things, because nowadays all science and technology branches has a prefix of nano. We have nanophysics, nanochemistry, nanomechanics, nanocomposite, nanotoxicology, lot of things. And we are chemist, I'm chemist, so we do nanochemistry, and using the nanochemistry, we can prepare different kind of shapes, morphology, it's called morphology of nanoparticles. It could be quantum dot, that is zero dot, the nanosphere, nanowire, nanofiber, nanoflower, anything. And if you just see the scale, this scale, this image you can get anywhere in books and in internet, it shows the difference between size region where the nanoparticle stays. So by definition, if it is a less than 100 nanometer particle, 100 nanometer particle, then it is called nanoparticle. And you can see the size of other particles, and that slide we can have in, we can understand more. So if you see this slide, we can see how big a nanometer or how small one nanometer. So in one nanometer, we can have water molecules, nitrogen, hydrogen, oxygen. So these molecules are not into the scale, but you can have the understanding in one nano, how small one nanometer. And in this one, we can understand that the nano is the middle ground, because we know about, from earlier days, we know about the galactic scale, that is the distance between stars, planets. Then we have a macroscopic scale where we can see the articles, items with our naked eyes. Okay. And then the microscopic scale where you can see the items or the particles by the microscope, through the microscope, say RBC, red blood, this one, red blood cells. Then one more scale we knew earlier, that is the atomic scale, where we have the atoms, molecules, those are in picometer level, right? And then one new scale come, that is the nanoscale, that is in between molecular or atomic scale and microscopic scale. So in the nanometer scale, the particles used to be in the nanometer region, that is below 100 nanometer. So thing is that, as you know, that we have a lot of good paper, lot of good publication, lot of projects, lot of applications, so of nanoparticles in different domains. So why the nanoparticles are so useful? What is the importance? So importance is that there are many points actually. There are a lot of advantages of nanoparticles over the bulk counterpart. Okay, the first one is the high surface area. That is the common thing we know everyone, that that it has. When we ask, that people say that it is the high surface area. Then because of the high surface area, actually even this is the reason, but there are many factors after that What is the outcome there? Because of the high surface area, we have more number of unsaturated surface atoms. Okay, more number of dangling bonds, unsaturated bonds, and that's why we have more number of active sites. So even high surface area is a basic thing, but the main thing is that because of this thing happen, unsaturated surface atoms, dangling bonds, active sites, so the nanoparticle, it become very active for any kind of application. So for example, catalytic application, for energy storage, for a drug delivery, because of those properties, the nanoparticle become very highly active. For example, porous structure, when you make nanoparticle, with different means, not all nanoparticles become porous, but few of them become, we can make it porous. And because of that, we can have intercalation of electrolyte, and we can have high surface area and more diffusion type of reaction, and we can have high energy storage or charge storage. Then we can make construction of different facets. Means when we have the material, any kind of material, oxide or alloy, all this, if it is crystalline material, it has some preferred facets, surface, say 1-1-1, 2-2-2, H complex, if you know. And those facets, they have peculiar reactivity. Few of them have more electron density on that, because those surfaces, they have more unsaturated surface atoms. And when the surface atoms are unsaturated, the electrons associated with those atoms are free. That means those are the dangling bonds. So those facets used to be highly reactive. I'll show some of the examples in my work if I get some time. Then that's why we can get turnover, increased turnover frequency. Then one more thing is about the tunable band gap. I think you have seen Professor D.D. Stoner's lecture that we can tune the band gap of semiconductor nanoparticle from the blue region to the red region. So a lot of importance and good things are from nanoparticles. So one slide I want to show you why we say high surface area and why the more number of unsaturated surface atoms. You can see this slide. So if we have a big particle, say for this one, you can see if I have a 1 centimeter cube particle, and if I compare with that one 1 nanometer cube, so 1 centimeter cube is 1 sugar cube. You can imagine in your mind, and if you take 1 nanometer cube, that's a very small one, and if you calculate the number of total number of surface atoms in both cases, total number of surface atoms, you get this value. And then if you calculate total number of atoms, means bulk atom, and you can get this value 10 to the 23, and here it is 100. And if you take the ratio, surface to volume ratio, surface to volume total number of atoms ratio, you can see in case of 1 nanometer particle, it is 0.6, and in case of 1 centimeter particle, it is 6 × 10⁻¹. That means 1 nanometer particle has lot of more surface atoms at the surface than the bulk particle. That means our 1 nanometer particle used to be very, very highly reactive. So you can see 10⁸ times of more atoms in the nanoparticle. So that is the reason behind that the nanoparticles are highly active. So how to prepare the nanoparticles? So there are a lot of methods, fabrication of nanomicrostructure. Fundamentally, there are two approaches we use, people use. One is called top-down and one is called bottom-up. So top-down is mainly the physics people use. So this is, say, we can understand from this slide. Top-down is that we are making some big thing to the small thing. It's a big particle to the small particle. For example, a ball milling is a good example of that. And you can see from this image, the sculptor, they are from they're making small ideals from the big stone. That is called the top down. And the bottom up, that is mainly chemist used by the chemical method, where we react the reactant, the atoms or the molecules to get the nanoparticle, the bigger particle. So we start from atomic size, we get nano size. And the upper side, we start from micron size and we get nanometer size. So there are several chemical synthesis approaches. That's what we are going to discuss today. So these are the chemical approaches. We are discussing the bottom-up approach in this today's lecture. And there are several methods. People use them based on their requirement. One is the colloidal synthesis method, then pro-precipitation method, Sol-Zell method, hydrothermal method, microwave hydrothermal, microemulsion, sonochemical method. and few more are there, but these are the popular methods people use all over the world. So let's see what are the methods and what are the chemistry behind that. And before that, we have to know about the colloids. So by definition, colloids are dispersed small particle less than 1000 nanometer of size. Okay, and colloidal particles, they are thermodynamically unstable. Why it is unstable? Because dg, that is the change in the Gibbs phi energy, that is very high. So dg is equal to lambda into d sigma. So just please pay attention in this equation. So dg is equal to gamma, that is that interfacial surface tension. Now again, if we come back to the our earlier slide, I said in this one, in this slide, I said that it has now high surface area and a lot of high surface atoms. So we have the surface tension, interfacial surface tension between the particle increases, okay, when the particle size is reduced. And the sigma is the change in surface area. Now both are increasing when the surface when the particle size is reduced. So Gibbs phi energy become very high, and because of that our colloidal nanoparticles are thermodynamically unstable. But we don't need thermodynamically unstable particles for our any kind of application. And if it is very unstable, then these small particles try to agglomerate. They will agglomerate. Then what is bulk material? Bulk material is thermodynamically stable. It is opposed to the colloidal particle. And as I said in the earlier slide, that these nanoparticles are, these say colloidal particles are, if you they are unstable, then we need some stabilizer. Some we need something. If you see the red line, stable colloidal dispersal required and interfacial stabilizer. So generally during the synthesis, we use surfactant or capping agent to make the nanoparticles stable, because as you see that these particles are, they have very high interfacial tension. Okay, so reduce the tension, so we apply or we use surfactant which or capping agent which stabilizes the nanoparticle to agglomerate. Because if we have the agglomerate nanoparticle, we cannot apply them for good application. So and that is the case that we have to stabilize the colloidal nanoparticle, and we have to prepare something in the size and shape that we can use them for good application. Because always that what is called non-monodispersed particle means, if it is non-monodispersed means it is a, all particles are equal size, and if it's polydispersed means the particles are not of same size, so we cannot use them for very good application. Because as from the definition you see, few particles have 10 nanometer and few nanoparticles have 100 nanometer. So both the particles quantum mechanically, they will show different properties, correct? Because what 10 nanoparticle, it may be confined from all the three directions, three dimensions. So the but in the 100 nanometer particle, it may be confined only from one directions, or it may not confine. So it may show different optical properties or magnetic properties than the 10 nanometer particle. Then so if we have mixture of these particles, we will not get a uniform properties. So how do you synthesize a nanoparticle? So a very simple thing I'm showing in this slide. So if you want to prepare a nanoparticle, what we can do in our BSc lab itself, we can just add cadmium salt, say cadmium nitrate, and sodium sulfide is for sulfur for the sulfur pickers, as a sulfur pickers. Just dissolve them in water, okay, and make a solution of soluble precursor, and then mix them and just stir that, and you will get cadmium sulfide nanoparticle. And if you want to prepare zinc nanoparticle, then just take a salt of zinc and do some stirring, just heating, you will get the nanoparticle. But the thing is that, and we'll get the nanoparticle like that what I am showing at the bottom. So few of the particles are very big, few of them are very small, and they are not in uniform shape, morphology, size, and this thing we do not need. If you see here that what we need just for the synthesis, we need energy required for decomposition of the precursor, means whatever the salt we used earlier, cadmium nitrate, sodium sulfide, just we need to dissolve in that water. Then there will be thermal collision between the precursor cadmium ion and the sodium and the sulfur ion. Then there will be reaction, and then we have the final combination product, combined product, that is cadmium sulfide. But basically this is for a BSc lab practical, so we can get cadmium sulfide, zinc sulfide, but for sure I'm telling these particles are useless, we cannot use them. for good any kind of application. So to use for very nice application, as we have learned these days, so we have to follow few of the rules. And if you see, these are the size and shape of different nanoparticles. One is 0D, 1D, 2D, and complex or 3D, we can say. So 0D is the spherical nanoparticles where all the dimensions are confined as per the quantum mechanical definition or quantum mechanical behavior. Okay. In 1D, the quantum mechanical behavior is confined in one dimension and the other remaining dimensions are not confined. Say the thickness is in this nano wire or nano quantum or the nano rod is say 1 nanometer, 5 nanometer, but length could be 100 nanometer or 1 micron. So that doesn't matter, length doesn't matter, only the thickness matters here. Then the two-dimensional, that is called as a nanosheets. You heard about the nanosheets or nanoprism disc. These are confined in two dimensions, okay, x and y, but the z is very fast. Okay, so you can, if you see carbon nanosheets or this nowadays you can see layered double hydroxides, very famous. These are few microns of length, but their thickness is very small. So these nanoparticles, if we want to prepare, we have to follow different chemical methods. So for that, let's see what are the different theories. So particle formation, when we are doing a reaction as a chemist, as I say in this slide, we are reacting cadmium and sulfur, okay, in a solution. We take water solution, aqueous solution, both of them, and surfactant. I already explained why we use surfactant to stabilize the nanoparticle. We add everything and we want to do the biosynthesis. When they start doing the reaction, they are in solution phase, right? So first we have to have the nucleation. That is the first part. So particle formation, theory of nucleation and systems. Okay. If you see what is nucleation, that is the crossing of phase boundaries. So we chemists, we start from the liquid phase. So our precursors are in the liquid and it has to go to the solid phase. Correct? Or say some physicists, when they do the condensation reaction, so they do or some other the solid phase reaction also. So first they have to go through the, or we have to go through the nucleation process, where the first, very first nucleation starts. Okay, the first nucleation means it is called cluster by definition. Cluster as a few, it is a combination of few atoms. Okay, so nucleation starts. If you see here, nucleation may be defined as the first irreversible formation of the nucleus cluster at the equilibrium phase. So we are reacting cadmium 2 plus and sulfur 2 minus. They are reacting. So if it is only from cadmium sulfide, that is a molecule. We don't need molecule. We need a cluster. We need a nanoparticle. So from a nanoparticle, first we have to form the cluster. And cluster means few, means not one cadmium or one sulfur. We need, say, around 5 to 10 cadmium and sulfur. They should form a undissolved solid starting point. That is a irreversible formation at equilibrium. Okay, and if you see on the second line, it is written nucleation prerequisite, that is to bring the system temporarily into a thermodynamically unstable state. Okay, that is the first case of nucleation, and we will have the nucleation means we have followed the rules that cadmium and zinc, cadmium and sulfur minus, they form the cluster. That is the beginning thing. Okay, so if we do not keep it in equilibrium, so what, there are two factors. What will happen? Either that will grow to a bigger particle, or those will again dissolve to the their ionic spaces. So that we don't want. We want that it should grow and we should get the nanoparticle. So one famous theory, it is called classical nucleation theory. This theory is very fun. It is very, this theory is very famous, and it is given at different time by Volmer, Becker, Frankel, and Zeldovich. And those are not actually for nanoparticle, those are for the formation of particle. But these are further, say, modified for the classical nucleation theory of nanoparticles. Okay, now see what is called classical nucleation theory. And this is, you can see, this is available in the books. We can see this diagram. It says how, when we are doing the reactions, how the groups gives free energy changes with time and with the size of the particle. Okay, size of the, I'm telling particle, I'm talking not nanoparticle. So when we are starting the reaction, with time, what happened? There are two kinds of different Gibbs free energy. Okay, the total Gibbs free energy is given by delta G, which is a combination of surface Gibbs free energy, change of Gibbs free energy, when there is delta, you know that is a change in the Gibbs free energy. Surface Gibbs free energy and the volume means the total Gibbs free energy. That is, the volume is given by T and the surface is given by S. So the volume surface Gibbs free energy given by delta mu V. This is the equation where you know pi r is the radius of the particle. Okay, and that is the interfacial tension, right? So interfacial tension term is absent in the volume term, and that is the total energy is given by delta, total delta G, that is, which we have to consider both of them. Now when it is a nanoparticle, you see nanoparticle, though delta GV or delta mu V will be very minimal, and that is the main predominant factor which is controlling the reaction is delta mu S. So we have the gamma here, okay, and R is the radius of the particle, which is given by minus D to gamma by delta GV. And what is R star here? It is unstable or critical nuclei, means that is the means after the formation, that is a state, that is the R state. R star is a state where, as I said just in the last slide, that either from that you can go to the left side, means you can go to the solution phase again, or you can go to the right side where you can have the particle, and the total energy, our delta delta mu S will reduce because total surface energy will be reduced, and we get a stable particle. Okay, if we continue that one, so we get, that is the delta G critical, free energy critical is given by 4 pi r c cube, that is the critical radius, square by 3. And from that we have the famous thing, that is the J is called rate of nucleation. That is the most important part. Rate of nucleation means how fast, how slow the nucleation will be there. It is given by A is equal to exponential of delta G by KT. And if you see this equation, in that equation we have ln delta, and that ln delta is given by this equation, all the expressions you know already, where delta is the ratio of solution concentration, and that is the equilibrium solution concentration, and P is the molar volume, T is the temperature, right? So what is the important factor now comes here? Delta, that is the ratio of solution concentration. Now based on this equation, you can see this is the reduction of overall Gibbs free energy of a supersaturated solution. So when we are making the solution, either we can make the supersaturation, means a highly concentrated solution, and it may be lower. If we have a very lower concentration, then we will not have any reaction, we have only few particles. If we have very higher supersaturated solution, so we should have very high rate of nucleation. That we can see in the next slide. But after, means we have to cover all this, and we have to follow the calculation, and we have done the calculation, and the final J, the rate of nucleation, is given by this equation. No need to go learn all these equations. The three important parameters are there in this equation. Those parameters are temperature, T is there, then degree of supersaturation, delta is the interfacial tension, gamma is there. So temperature we know, degree of supersaturation means that is the concentration of the solution, and gamma is the interfacial tension. So if you see the equation, you can see that your J means it is the rate of nucleation is directly proportional to the temperature, okay, because it is exponential, it is 1 by T. So if T is increased, now this, that's what I want to explain, that if T is increasing, our rate of nucleation will increase, okay. Then our gamma and delta is in the inverse state. So if delta is also in the in this part only. So supersaturation increases, means if the concentration of the solution increases, then the nucleation increases, and if gamma decreases, nucleation increases. So when we want to do some chemical synthesis, we want to do a synthesis of nanoparticle very nicely, if we follow these three factors, so we can get very nice nanoparticle of monodisperse. Means if we increase the temperature, there will be lot of nucleations, okay, of all equal size. And if we increase the concentration, if we use a supersaturated concentration, then we'll have lot of nucleation, okay. And if we somehow decrease the interfacial tension, that is the use of the surfactant or capping agent, then we can get lot of nucleations. Okay, because we need the nucleation. We need, say, one left nucleation. For example, I'm telling you, we don't need 1,000 nucleation, because if 1,000 nucleation will be there, then there will be uncontrolled growth, or they can again come back to the solution phase. So we need more nucleation. And when we have the nucleation, then there used to be three phases: phase one, phase two, phase three. Where in phase one there will be no nucleation, as I said, it will go back to the again solution phase. So we should be in the second phase, and this second phase we can get using this following these three parameters. Okay, so following this thing, we can move faster. Then once we have the nucleation, okay, we cannot stop the reaction, because that nucleation means this is a cluster. That is a say it may be 1 nanometer or maybe less than 1 nanometer. So at that time means we cannot detect also, and we don't need those small particles, because those particles have a tendency to go back to the solution phase. So what we have to do? We have to increase the size of the particle. And when we have increased the particle size, there are two parameters or two definition. One is called focusing of size distribution, and one is called defocusing of size distribution. Actually, a good chemist, they need focusing of size distribution, because we need equal size nanoparticles. When focusing of size distribution occurs, so if monomer concentration in solution is higher than solubility of existing nanocrystal, or nanocrystal will grow and size distribution narrow, right? But that's what we need, a super saturated solution or highly concentrated solution during the synthesis. But if we use our concentration of the solution, say cadmium solution, sulfur solution is very less, so we will not get good particle. So what will happen? Some of the particle will means they will go back to the solution phase, they will dissolve, and because of we have new precursors, so that will again absorb onto the bigger particle, and the bigger particle will grow. So we have to consider these two parameters. And when we focus the when we do the focusing of the size distribution, focusing of size distribution for monodisperse particle, what we'll do? We'll do a subsequent growth of nuclei. How it is happen? Is that the mechanism given? So there are four steps: the generation of the growth species. So we already have the monomers, that is the nucleation. Then diffusion of the growth species. Growth species means those are the monomers, means what we have, our ionic solution, ions. From the solution, it is called bulk. Bulk means the solution. They move to the, when they diffuse through the solution to the surface of the clusters. Okay. Then in the third phase, what happened? Adsorption of the growth species onto the monomer or the cluster. And finally, the surface growth plays irreversibly incorporation of the growth species onto the solid surface. So by that we'll have the very nice monodispersed nanoparticle. And if we follow that, what we get, we can get very nice nanoparticle. And one more important point here I want to mention. So when we do the synthesis of various nanoparticle using the solution phase, so what the advantages we get? Stabilization, we can stabilize the nanoparticle with the surfactant. Then we can extract from the solvent. These we do not get in the physical methods, or say top down methods. Then we can modify the surface, we can process the, we can control the process, and we can do mass production. We'll see all of them. So first synthesis method I want to discuss here, the volatile synthesis method or high temperature synthesis method, where we use a round bottom flux. We have a thermometer inserted it, or this thermocouple, and we have a condenser, we have a then series here, with which we can inject the reactant. Then we can do the reaction at very high temperature, because we use organic solvent here. Okay, so what are the advantages? The high yield, size control, monodisperse, safe control, alloying, doping, heterostructure, everything we can make with this method. Okay, this is a very simple method. But it is difficult to maintain. We have to maintain a degassing system. We have to degas the complete system inside this one, inside the RB. Then we have to flush gases to make it inert. And we have to inject the required material at a good time interval. So there are many reactants, and the surfactants are generally what we use in this kind of thing. Then sodium dodecyl sulfate, these are the ionic. Then other sulfate is other surfactants are used, triethyl phosphine, tributyl phosphine, octyl phosphine oxide, TOP, TOPO, then hexyl phosphonic acid, etc. Because those have very high boiling point. Then solvent, we use water, ethanol, toluene, TOPO, octadecin. If it is a high temperature reaction, people generally use TOPO, octadecin, oleic acid, etc. Then any kind of metal precursors we can use during the synthesis. And this is a famous top synthesis in the ZACS in 1993. You can see the citation of this paper is more than 5,000. This is the first synthesis actually using this synthesis method. It is cadmium selenide, cadmium sulfide, cadmium selenide, telluride nanoparticles. Okay, followed using this colloidal synthesis method. So basically, this is the what we discussed right just now. This is the theory, and it is followed exactly what is given there. So during this course of time, you can see at the very beginning when we as I said, when we inject the metal precursor, say cadmium phosphate and TOPO, TOP selenium into the reactant solution, they start immediately the nucleation, okay, at the zero time. And then you can see it is the concentration of the precursor and the nucleation start and it increases. And after that, you can see growth take place, okay? And you can see the particle size increases, okay? That is what the classical nucleation theory explains. And people get this kind of nanoparticle. These are the, you can equal size, and you can see these are the surfactant, TOPO or triethyl phosphine surfactant, which are hindering the nanoparticle to agglomerate. As we discussed at the beginning, they are stabilizing the nanoparticle, they are not allowing them to agglomerate and precipitate. And I think you have seen this kind of images in the first lecture, and you can see we can make different kind of nanoparticle. If you see in this one, you can make say 1 nanometer particle, 2 nanometer, 5, 10, 100 nanometer particle, and based on that we can get this kind of emissions under UV light. Okay, and these are the few of the nanoparticles I synthesized earlier. And you can see, you can see they are monodisperse, and you can see you cannot find out actually a single particle with different size there. All of them are equal shape, equal size, and equal morphology. You can see all of them are hexagonal, all of them are spherical particles. And these are produced using the colloidal synthesis method. We can prepare magnetic nanoparticles also, oxides also, using this synthesis method. These are two examples from the literature. This is iron oxide nanoparticle. So, as I said, what it means, why we get a different shape? So, first we get, okay, nucleation we get monodisperse particle, we get a lot of nanoparticle. But as I said that, that we know that we can get nanorods, or we can get, say, nanoprism, we can get multipods, we can get spherical particles, different shapes of particles. How to shape, how to give the shape evaluation, means how to get the shape. That is again, we have to know how to, because just see, generally one call is called a facile synthesis. Facile synthesis means it is automatically happening. We are putting the reactant together, and we are putting something, and we are getting the product. And by chance, we are getting, say, nanoship, nanorod, nanosphere. That is facial synthesis, facile synthesis. People say it is called facile synthesis. And some of the synthesis where we say we are doing purposefully, means we want nano rod only. So we have to follow some theory, and based on that, means if we follow those theory, those protocol, we will get only nanoparticles. So there are many theories based on, but above that, the two are very popular, peculiar, and it is used. First one is the Gibbs theory, Wolf theorem, thermodynamic theory, and second one is the effective monomer model. So I will explain both of them. So thermodynamic theory, it says the shape of the crystal is determined by the surface free energy of individual crystallographic phase. Okay. At the beginning, I said that we have the HKL phase, HKL way, and lattice plans and the facets. So the shape of the morphology, we can determine from that also. And other thing is an effective monomer model, where the free energy of different crystallography phases is manipulated throughout the reaction by sequential injection addition of effective monomer preparers. So let's see how it does. So we these two same evolution mechanism, we can get all these kind of different shape. You can see we can get nano rods, nanowires. Then these are the cadmium selenide, cadmium sulfide, cadmium telluride. I am showing mainly the first reports actually. I am not showing new reports. I consider here the very first reports of all these kinds. Okay. So we can see very nice nanorods, tetrapods, octapods, all these things. And these are produced following these two mechanisms. First, we follow the classical nucleation theory. We got the nucleation. And then we have to follow these methods to get these shapes. Okay. So what happened? How we get? So that is called anisotropic growth. So when we have a crystalline particle, means it is, I'm not telling you a nanoparticle. This is a cadmium selenide cluster. Okay, cluster means if you make the DFT calculation, or if we can get in the book. If we see, this is a hexagonal lattice actually. It is a hexagonal crystal structure. It has these facets. Okay. And these are the surface facets of these are 001, 100, and 100 minus 1. Out of that, this cadmium selenide is 001 and 00 minus 1 facets are unstable, reactive, 100 is stable, it is non reactive. So, what people did, they did the engineering, it is called nano engineering. Means they did the, mean they purposefully they said that okay, now what we'll do, we will bring our precursor, the reactant, cadmium and sulfide, sulfur, only to these planes. Okay, we will hinder, protect this surface, means we will prohibit the absorption of monomer. Interlinked only monomer onto these surfaces, means cadmium and sulfide will not come here, only it will come here. Then what will happen? We'll get nanorods, means there will be elongation in this axis. Okay, there will be no growth on this 100. So by that we can get only nanorods. And how will happen? First thing is the crystallographic point. This is the thing we'll discuss here. Sorry, discuss in the first point. And second point is that, so we have to hinder. How will hinder? We will use some surfactant which is strongly binding to this 100 plan and which is not strongly binding to this one, weakly binding. So when it is weakly binding, so when the precursor will come, it is only bind to the 001 and 00 minus 1. And this is, it is specified now, 100. So there will be no growth. You see the beauty of nano engineering. That is the nano engineering actually. It looks like, okay, very simple synthesis, but you can see that is the beauty behind this kind of synthesis. And these are, based on this thing, I have prepared these nanoparticles. During my postdoc only, so we can see octapods, multipods, you can see very nice nanoparticles, and these are all based on our nano engineering. Okay, and you can do all these things following the collagen synthesis method. Okay, so we learned a lot about the collagen synthesis method, so we are moving to the hydrothermal method. Why this is coming? Okay. Sorry. So hydrothermal synthesis method, this is one of the very popular synthesis methods many people use, I also use. So the theory behind is that, so we are cooking something inside the hydrothermal vessel, or many times we call it bomb also, inside something below the actual melting temperature, below the actual boiling temperature because of the high pressure. That is the thing, means it's like a pressure cooker. What we do inside a pressure cooker, because you know that boiling point of water is 100 degrees centigrade, but when it is high pressure in because of the seal vessel, that boiling point, you can see it is it will change, right? And based on that, we can have the synthesis, we can do the synthesis, and we can get very nice nanoparticles using that one. So we can prepare a lot of different kind of nanoparticle. We can get oxide nanoparticles, chalcogenide nanoparticle, we can use alloy nanoparticles. But the theory behind it, you have to remember that the weak energy involved by the pressure, because pressure is increased. The negative delta V, that is the change in the volume, that leading to the denser phase, we get good dense nanoparticle. Okay, but in this case, we have to remember the condition. There are two conditions. solvent above boiling point, that is the supercritical water, means the water becomes supercritical. The second point is that we have to use bases most of the time. Potassium hydroxide generally used, or sodium hydroxide. Why this is used? Because if you see this slide, this is again from one publication. Sorry, I forgot to put the reference here. I'm sorry for that. So this is a synthesis of barium titanate. So barium and titanium, if we do the reaction, we get again barium titanate. But barium or carbonate and titanium, and if we add potassium hydroxide, same thing we get. But this, you see the difference in the reaction. The red one with KOH and the black one without KOH. And you can see that same kind of reaction we can do at, because see delta G, the change in Grignard energy is more negative, right? So at the same lower temperature than the without potassium hydroxide. So potassium hydroxide, when we add base in the during the reaction, it increases the solubility of the precursor, and we can do the reaction at a lower temperature. Okay, that is a very good point. Actually, it is yes, we can follow that. And if we follow, do this one, you can see people have prepared different kind of nanoparticles. This is a very, again I'm telling, it is an old paper. So by just changing the temperature, you can get cubic phase, cubic nanoparticle, that's spherical nanoparticle, then rock kind of nanoparticle. You have to change the temperature, and you have to use some base there during the reaction. This is a sodium lithium fluoride nanoparticles. Okay, then I move to a sonochem. Here I am just because see, most of the synthesis we follow all this nucleation theory only. We discuss all this theory in details, in depth. Just I'm now discussing the synthesis method, just very simply. One more method people use, that is a sonochemical method or sonochemical method, that is the ultrasonic method. So ultrasonic method, you know, that is a sonic method is used at very high frequency. So what is the basic theory behind that? That is called hotspot theory and acoustic cavitation. Just I'm simply telling one in one sentence that when we do the sonication, so water, we do in water, right? So that bubbling used to form there. You can see a lot of bubbling when we do the sonication. The sonication is mainly used for cleaning also by the jewelries. So due to that bubbling, there used to be a hotspot. It means a very small bubble used to form in the solution. And the temperature of that bubble, it is called hotspot, it goes to 5000 to 25000 Kelvin. It's very high, you can imagine, 25000 Kelvin. But the problem is that the time period, means that for what time it remained there is very low, means it is a nanosecond. You can see the very cooling rate, 10 to the power 11 Kelvin per second, means it immediately in nanosecond it becomes coming to the room temperature. Okay, but whatever the temperature it happened, that was maximum enough to decompose the precursor and to have the reactions, and we can get nanoparticles of different kinds, say gold, cobalt, iron, nickel, etc., then oxides also. But what is the main disadvantage? That we get mainly amorphous nanoparticles. We do not get crystalline nanoparticle, and we do not get beautiful or good for monodisperse nanoparticle using this method. So these are the nanoparticle you can see. These are not looks very good because you can see polydisperse nanoparticle. So then one man method, reverse micelle method. Professor Ganguly is expert in this method. He has done very synthesis. Even Professor Toki Hamid also, he has done a lot of work on this. He's very expert in that one. So you know that is the micelle and reverse micelle theory from our soap and detergent solution. So this is also a very simple method, and we can, using this method, we can get very nice nano, because you know that when we have some precursor, it will have a positive side and positive head and negative head, right? Metal ions, they are positive. So when we have this, we form the reverse micelle. So their negative tail part of the micelle, right, that is the organic molecule mainly. So they are forming the cavity where we have the metal particles or the precursor, and they react and we get the final particle, right? So this is the thing. So we use NLE, SDS, TMAB, AOT, etc. as the micelle. Mainly these are the used micelles, and we get very nice nanoparticles. Okay, and we use reducing agent also, and then mixing, and inside the cavity, that is the micelle part, right? Inside the reverse micelle, we have the nanoparticles. And to get say nano rod kind of thing, we use different kind of micelles. So here I'm just running. I'm not discussing much, and we can get very nice nanoparticles here, and you can get nano rods. Spherical nanoparticle, nano cube, many kind of thing. Then the one last synthesis method is the metal salt reduction, and this is very simple thing. You can just add some reducing agent to the metal salt, and you can get the metal nanoparticle. These methods are used to get gold nanoparticle, silver, cobalt, nickel, etc. nanoparticle. But even though the methods is very simple, but to get a good monodisperse particle, we have to follow all those protocols. So this is a famous again slide to get different kind of gold nanoparticles. You have to take the gold salt, that is the this aurum chloride. This is gold free. Then sodium citrate. Sodium citrate acts as a surfactant here, capping agent. Then use sodium borohydride. This is the reducing agent. And you react for different time, different thing. Then you can get different. It is the last method we can do in our chemistry lab at any time. Just add iron 2 salts and iron 2 salt. Say iron ferric hydroxide and ferrous hydroxide. You can start from ferric sulfate and ferrous sulfate. And add it to sodium hydroxide by the burette and just add it. What you will get? You will get a black not precipitate, black colloidal solution, black liquid. And if we bring a magnet near to the, you just decant the upper part, water part, and if you bring a magnet there, you will get spikes. Means you are forming actually magnetic liquid, that is iron oxide nanoparticle, is called magnetic fluid. That you can do in our lab. So these are the various synthesis method. This is called synthesis diversity, synthesis diversion we use in the chemistry. If I have time, I will just give you few of my slides. These are the advantages and disadvantages. I will not go through this. You can take a snapshot of this one. If you want to read further, you want to know this thing, so we can read these books. So these are the basics about all these kind of things. So just I will take, can I take 5 more minutes, 5-10 minutes, Professor Ahmed?
Yeah, you can.
Yes. So after knowing all these synthesis methods, so what we do in our lab in Delhi University, so we follow synthetic nanochemistry methods to make nanoscale building blocks to get 0D, 1D, 2D, etc. We do the characterization and then we get desired shape, size, and do quantum dots. If you have seen already those particles, then we do some application for the energy part, energy conversion, water splitting, some catalysis, and energy storage also. So during this using this synthesis, so at various time we have prepared various of nanoparticles for different applications. So these are in 2015 we prepared a facet selective or say active cerium oxide nanoparticles, which were very good for oxidation reactions, organic transformation reactions, and that was an Indian patent also granted. And means now I will not take time to discuss the characterization material part, but you can see that when we followed this synthesis, we have synthesized material with 100111 plants, and out of that 11100 plant is highly active, and we have prepared the nanoparticles with highly active 100 facets exposed. And further, we followed the work, and we have developed another synthesis method. In 2014, and here we followed the colloidal synthesis method, and this was in ACS catalysis at the time. And we followed those synthesis method. What we did, as we discussed, that with the crystal engineering and this nano engineering, we can block some surface, and we can make expose of the other surface. We made nano cube of cerium oxide. Few facets are completely blocked, precipitated, and few are open. and we get highly active surfaces, and those were good for say 100%, 99, more than 99% conversion and efficiency in paraxylene conversion to terephthalic acid. Okay, and this is again from the same paper, and we have explained the mechanism, and these are the characterization to say that with our synthesis method we have prepared that 10011 plane, that is the highly active surface, to make them exposed for the catalytic reactions. And this is another work. Then we make nanorods with cadmium, cerium oxide only. Those were found to be further highly reactive for oxidation of reactions from alcohol to aldehyde. Okay, you can see from the alcohol to aldehyde. Then another work what we did, means why I am showing all this thing, because we have followed those synthesis methods, those mechanisms, the theories, and we have prepared multiple twin silver nanoparticles, silver nickel alloy nanoparticle, as the highly active catalyst for multiple reduction and degradation reaction. And we have followed the same kind of synthesis method to make four graded alloy shell nanostructures. And you can see these are the this alloy structure which were very active in organic transformation reactions. Okay, then further, this is the this is a collagen synthesis here. We have followed those synthesis method to get a new type of two-dimensional cadmium selenide cadmium sulfide core shell dot in a hexagonal platelet. You can see this is a platelet. Actually, this is a platelet two-dimensional structure. And inside this platelet, hexagonal platelet, these are cadmium sulfide. Inside that, there's cadmium selenide nanoparticles. That is a core shell structure. And by that, we tune the band gap and we get some extraordinary optical properties out of these particles. And further, this was in 2014. In 2016, we have grown gold nanoparticle onto the surface of this particle. And you can see this is the diagram of that one. And this is again in nanoscale in 2016. And we can tune the band gap and we can find that these gold nanoparticles are used as an electron sink for the from this system. And those electron sink can be used for further photocatalytic reactions. Okay, just this is a current study. So in 2017, following this synthesis, we have prepared copper cobalt sulfide nanoparticle, nanosheets, two-dimensional nanosheets. After a lot of calculations, characterization, we found very nice 12 nanometer to 16 nanometer thickness. And these nanoparticles are found to be very good in the oxygen evolution reaction. And already in the last 3 days, there are a lot of lectures on this kind of thing. You know what is oxygen evolution reactions, and this nanosheets shown very good oxygen evolution reactions. And then recently, one cobalt sulfide nanoparticles are synthesized using the collagen synthesis method. This is a synthesis method, topo method, topo legacy doll element. We got a hollow nanoparticle of this copper sulfide. What is the beauty of that? This nanoparticle, it shows a robust and low cost pH universal oxygen evolution reaction, because our this copper copper cobalt sulfide, it shows oxygen evolution reaction only in basic media. But these are showing oxygen evolution reaction in acidic, in basic condition, in acidic as well as in neutral condition. Then further, this cobalt copper cobalt sulfide nanosheets, these nanosheets, they are showing highly photocatalytic water splitting hydrogen evolution reaction, that is in Journal of Metals Chemistry A in 2019. We got 25.9 millimole per millimole per gram per hour hydrogen. It was equivalent to, given here, 633 milliliter per gram of hydrogen. It is very good hydrogen evolution reaction. And that was possible only because of those synthesis and this nanosheet. Actually, all these mechanisms are there and reasons are there. I'm not discussing all this thing because of the time constraint. But these nanosheets are found to be have higher donor concentration and good band edge situation, means that your conduction band, valence band positions are there. because of that we are getting very good evaluation. Then there is a then we have prepared a carbon nano carbon nitrate nano sheets. It's showing very nice adhesion evolution reaction. Then as I'm moving to the last slides, so just I want to show, because our today's talk is on synthesis only, so evolution of nanoparticles. So we can see with our synthesis method we prepared nickel cobalt nickel cobalt oxide octahedral nanoparticles. You can see here this is the synthesis scheme, and we have used this nanoparticle as a super bending high voltage operating metal oxide flexible superparticles. Okay, so not going further, you can see these are the beautiful nanoparticles, octahedral nanoparticle, you can see from the SEM images. And these are the device actually, multifolding. We can fold from 0 degree to 180 at different angle. You can see 0, 45, 135, etc. And these are the parameters, electrochemical parameters. We'll not discuss. We can twist the cell. We can bend and twist. Yeah, and this is the recent paper in ACS Applied Nanomaterial. This is again flexible supercapacitor twisting and bending using double hydroxide nanosheets, layer double hydroxide nanosheets. These are all, we follow the same kind of synthesis method. We did the nano engineering. We have increased the number of active facets, active sites, then the surface area, then porosity, etc. Because of that, we got all these good properties. So finally, I'd like to thank first my student Meenakshi, Kiran, Kalyan, Mukesh, Himani, and Bindu Antil. Then my collaborators, C.S. Gopinath, Manas Rendan Das, S.A. Hasmi. And I thank Delhi University for the facilities, then DST, SCRB, then UCDU, SAIT AIMS for different characters facility, then BARC, then CSR and DST Technology Mission Dev Mission Division for recent projects. And this is my DU on the left side, and on the right side, this is the Department of Chemistry, Delhi University. I welcome you from to that department. And thank all of you for your kind attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shashank, for very energetic, very informative, and a great lecture. And you have started your talk from very basic concepts of the synthesis, and then you have shown the good results that you obtained from your research lab. And I hope that all the participants are witness today to see the kind of work that Dr. Shashank is doing in Delhi University. So now I request Dr. Fana Riaz to please come up and ask 2-3 questions, not more than that, because Dr. Shashank has to go somewhere in other class. So 2-3 questions you can ask, and then please conclude this lecture with the vote of thanks to Dr. Shashank. Dr. Riaz.
Good afternoon, Dr. Shashank. I hope you're doing well.
So, hello, good afternoon. Thank you.
So we'll take up the questions. The first question is, which type of stabilizer can be used for nanoparticle synthesis to control the size?
Yes, actually, that is the question, right? So we means all people, they use different kind of stabilizer. So a stabilizer, I said that this is mainly surfactant capping agent are used. So based on what kind of nanoparticle we are synthesizing, and the synthesis method we are doing, based on that we use the stabilizer. For example, if it is a aqueous based synthesis, if we are doing the synthesis in water or ethanol, so then we should not use the organic stabilizer, okay, TOPO, TOP, phosphonic acid, amines, all these things. Then we use mainly the aqueous based surfactants, SDS, PMAB, etc. And if we do the organic based synthesis, definitely we have to use the organic based stabilizers. And sorry, one more thing, that if we use long chain stabilizer, say octyl oleic acid, all these things, so generally we get very small particles because we have a very long chain, and long chain means the inter repulsion will be also more, so there will be very less space for the particle. And if we want bigger particle little bit, then we should use small short chain stabilizers.
So do these nanoparticles have the tendency to react with the surfactant?
No. That's why it is called surfactant. They are not reacting, because see, when we are doing the reaction, we are doing the reaction at very high temperature, right? At 300 degree temperature, that is very, very high temperature. So if the surfactant are reactive, then they will react at that temperature itself. So they don't react. The active end of the surfactant, they react with the surface atom just to stabilize. So otherwise they don't react.
So can we optimize the high temperature, which is around 380 degrees in a round bottom flask?
Yes, yes, we can do that. But we need our normal round bottom flask. If it is a good quality, it will go. But whatever we are getting in the local market, please don't go with those. And they will break at 100 degree or 200 degree. So we need a good quality RV flask to go to that temperature. But it is possible.
Then which two-dimensional materials are suitably preferred for supercapacitors?
See, it is again based on the material, because any kind of material, if you can prepare in two dimensions, that is possible, but it should have a redox property. Means in for supercapacitor, there are different mechanisms, right? It is a redox reaction, ferritic reaction, diffusion mechanism. So if that material shows that kind of reaction, so you can prepare those nanosheets or two-dimensional material. So mainly people are making hydroxide nanosheets, okay? Nickel hydroxide, cobalt hydroxide, or even you can make oxide nanosheets also, two-dimensional, I'm telling.
So is there any synthetic method which is most preferable to get accurate two-dimensional nanomaterials?
No, yes, you can. No, but we cannot tell that for this kind of material you will get only this nanosheets. You have to do some calculation based on that. Because graphene will, or graphene oxide, you will get always nanosheets, right? This carbon nitride, what we prepare in our lab also. Those also we get nanosheets also, because they're the original, you know, that is the one-dimensional sheets, right? Sorry, two-dimensional, that's the their structure, you know. But in other cases, for example, nickel hydroxide, cobalt hydroxide. So if you follow that criteria, then definitely you will get nanosheets. Means you have to hinder the growth in all directions.
Okay, so thank you, Dr. Sasank, for being with us, for accepting our invitation in a very short span of time, and then giving the wonderful information with your remarkable presentation on to the participants about the structural aspects and the synthesis aspects of nanoparticles. It has been really very informative to all the participants. And I thank you for being with us. We are very fortunate to usually have you in our department, and you get enlightened by your lectures and your visits to the department. And we hope to see you very soon. And we are really thankful and obliged that you accepted our invitation and have, you know, shared such a wonderful information with our participants. Thank you for being with us, Dr. Shashank. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank
Looking
you,
forward
thank
to
you.
See you.